how do we do surface mesoanalysis? Looks like my, or how we do it. It's not a question mark. I've often considered it detective work, that we've got data, and we're trying to figure out where the favorable areas for thunderstorm and severe weather development are going to occur before maybe even storms develop. That's our challenge. So we have to find and identify the thermodynamic characteristics of air masses, the presence of discontinuities or boundaries between the air masses. That's a key element. Thunderstorms like to develop where there's boundaries at times. Can we identify those boundaries in the data? But we have more to look at than just the surface obs themselves. We can look at radar. We can look at satellite. We have other sources of information that can help us a great deal. So if we really want to do a thorough analysis, we have to pay great attention to the data itself. Similar to what you were doing with the upper air charts, we have to do that with the surface charts, but then we're also going to blend in other observational data sources. And if we're doing this properly, we're not just kind of blindly drawing lines. We're thinking about it as we're doing the analysis. We're thinking about the individual pieces of data. And we can use other sources of information, satellite, mesonetworks, even at 500 millibars. If we know where there is a system and a tight thermal gradient, we know from a three-dimensional frontal structure, there's probably going to be a front somewhere out ahead of this particular system. We can use radar to help us see where storms have developed and perhaps they're associated with boundaries. We can look at lightning data. We can look at a lot of things to help us. So we can't really perform effective analysis if we only use the surface data itself. It's not going to resolve all of the boundaries that we are interested in. In the lower left here, here's a convective system in Missouri. And there's a boundary that comes back through here. You can see a different character of the clouds here. There's no clouds here. There's stable clouds here in eastern Nebraska, and then more cumuliform clouds farther back. This has laid down a boundary, and we can see it very clearly in the satellite data. And when we combine that with surface data, we know precisely where that boundary is at the time. Here's a close-up of another example where you can see the convective storms. You can see where the boundary was laid out. There's a Q field to the south, very little Q to the north. This tells us exactly where the boundary is, and we know where to place it then on our map. Here's another example. Where's the dry line? Well, in this particular case, if I don't have mesonet data here, I've got a 36 dew point at Amarillo. I've got a 37 down here at Lubbock. I've got a 63 at Childress. I know it's somewhere in here, but gee whiz, if I see this, this gives me an idea of exactly where it is. And it can help me with the placement of some of the boundaries. Here's another situation where we have some thunderstorms in southwest Nebraska, and they're going to lay out a boundary that pushes southwestward. And lo and behold, if we can track that boundary and know where it is, there might be new thunderstorm development on it. So it is important to pay attention to these types of boundaries, whether they be dry lines, whether they be convective outflow. They can be extremely important in terms of where thunderstorm development is going to occur. I'll let this go through one more time. Okay, so what type of boundaries are we looking at? Well, we're looking for standard fronts, cold front, warm front, quasi-stationary. We're also looking for smaller scales, such as sea breeze fronts. Sometimes we even see them on lakes or rivers. Convective outflow, differential heating boundaries where there's clouds and then less clouds, differences in vegetation, et cetera, dry lines, pressure troughs. They tend to not have much thermal contrast, but they can still be important, especially orographically induced troughs. And other convergence zones that may be also from orographic features. Denver convergence zone east of Denver is often a place where storms develop and become severe. So what are we looking for? These have been around a long time, these principles. We're interested in features that may be smaller than the synoptic network. That's one reason why we'll look at satellite, because satellite can help us with boundaries. We're going to include all available data, and we have to pay attention to detail. We're not necessarily going to ignore some data that at first looks to be out of place, unless we're certain it's an observational error. And then if we know what features, what boundaries have been placed on previous charts, we're going to continue to see if those are persisting. Continuity is important. So first thing we're going to do is try and find thermal and moisture gradients. I don't draw isobars first. I'll look at the satellite and radar and see if I can find boundaries there, and I'll just put it on the chart. And I can apply conceptual models of fronts, outflows when analyzing temperature, dew point, et cetera. And then I'm going to analyze the isotherms and isodrosotherms, particularly the isodrosotherms. I usually do it at 4 degrees. Some people do it at 5. I prefer to do it at 4 degree intervals because then I can interpolate to 2 if I need to and get a little more detail. If I draw 5 degree intervals, I'm really bad at thinking in terms of 2.5 degree intervals. So it works better for me to use 4. I'm going to use objective fields to help me. You know, theta E to locate gradients, temperature, dew point. I'm not proud. I'll use whatever I can have. Here's an example from an old paper by Neiman and Wakamoto looking at the theta field on the left, the theta E field on the right. If we look on the right, and we see right through here, it doesn't have a strong thermal character, but it certainly has a strong moisture discontinuity. This is a dry line in through here. But then you can also see in the theta field where the frontal boundary is probably occurring. So this can help us. Here's an example. This is in our surface OA in NMAP up in SPC. This is at 18Z on a particular day, and this is the theta analysis. And you can start to see some gradients. Here's another gradient back here. Here's a gradient in through here. Something's probably going on in there. We look at theta E, which includes moisture. Okay, I've got a different type of air mass in through here. And then I've got another gradient in through here, and maybe something across here. So what does this tell me? Well, if I take a look at that again, and I put the pressure field on, lo and behold, it might tell me something about frontal structure. And at least give me a hand in knowing where to look when I'm looking at the surface data. But we also have to be aware that some of the objective analysis fields may have some things in them that are not exactly right. Part of this could be the technique itself, some of the aspects of it. For instance, where there isn't a lot of data versus where there is data could affect the analysis. Maybe bad data could get into it. There will be weakening of gradients in areas of low data coverage. We can also have some maximum minima where there is no data at all in the data void. So I have to be careful. I'm going to give you an example here. Here is an objective analysis of surface dew point. This is an early August case. And in particular, it says, gee, we've got lower dew points here, less than 64 in Middle Tennessee, and then we've got extremely high dew points, northeast Arkansas, southeast Missouri. What's going on here? Do we believe it all? Should we? How are we going to know if this is correct or not? We don't have any surface data plotted on here, do we? So if we just look at objectively analyzed fields, what conclusions can we draw? What conclusions should we draw? Ooh, now we'll put the data up. Well, look at this. In Tennessee, Kentucky border, Hopkinsville, 63 dew point, 63 dew point. Well, maybe this min is right. How about over here? Well, there's a 76, 77, 74, 108. 108 dew point. Pretty reasonable. You're near the Mississippi River, right? Probably gets pretty humid. Wrong. That may have influenced that 80 degree dew point area. And this is something that if we use the observational data with the objective analysis, we can get a better idea of how good the objective analysis is. Look at what the difference it makes. This is surface-based lifted index. It goes from minus 10 to 0 with a really tight gradient in here if you're lifting the surface parcel. Or if you're looking at, if you don't have the data underneath it, how are you going to know what might be right? Here's the Cape field, surface-based Cape. It goes from 5,000 to 500, an order of magnitude difference. And again, without underlying surface data to give you a hint of what's going on, it may be hard to interpret objective fields all by themselves. So after we do thermal and moisture analysis, we use the pressure and wind data to complete Surface pressure pattern is often helpful, obviously, because boundaries often occur in pressure troughs. Wind shifts can help us to see where there may be boundaries. Even a rough streamline analysis that you can do yourself can help us focus areas of convergence. You may also see this in an objective sense. You may see it in a satellite imagery. Short-term surface pressure tendencies in terms of isobaric information at short time intervals can also help identify locations of boundaries, and they may give us implications of thermal advection or divergence aloft. If we have pressure falls at the ground, something's taking place above that in the vertical, whether it be warm advection or divergence to help that. So this is an example. We like to look if there's meso-lower, meso-high couplets in boundaries. Concentrated fall-rise couplet can enhance convergence in the area. So there's a lot of things that we should be looking at to try and pay attention. Here's an example of a surface chart from a number of years ago. Strong pressure rises behind the cold front. Pressure falls ahead of the cold front. This gradient tightened up as this low deepened over the lakes region. Cold front surged eastward, and almost continuous wind damage reports, except in the State College WFO area, where they did not call them thunderstorm wind gusts because they had a high wind warning out. Let me give you a couple examples. These are real-time analyses that our forecasters used. This was a potential severe weather case in the southeast US. These charts are from 22Z and then at 5Z at the end of the shift. You can see the changes in the fronts and the lows. Here's another case, January 2nd of 2015. You can see the primary better air mass was down in the Gulf of Mexico. The low was in the Gulf, but as the day went on, this goes to 14Z, moisture is increased inland. We have pressure falls, pressure rises with this system. And as we move ahead, you can start to see we issued MDs, talked about the analysis, composite convective outflow cold front, from the Jackson area southwestward, destabilizing air mass coming on in. You can see pressure falls developing in southern Mississippi, northern Louisiana area. Pressure falls kept increasing, this blue area in through here, immediately ahead of that boundary. Another meso discussion talking about meso low and robust area of pressure falls, and lo and behold, it was within this area, as these pressure falls tracked northeastward, we had a series of tornadoes. So paying attention to the surface data, analyzing it in detail, can be extremely helpful. So this is where we're going to get to. This is a zoom in of the surface chart from 0Z on the 27th. You had done chart upper air charts from 0Z on the 28th. So what I want to show you is what happened 24 hours earlier, and then you're going to get the charts from 0Z on the 28th. So this is how I would have gone about doing the analysis. I would have started with the isodrosotherms and put those on here so I can start to see, where's the moist axis? Where's the moisture source? How high is the moisture? What's the magnitude of it? I can also look on here and see I've got dew points in the 60s. I've got dew points in the teens and hot temperatures. So that tells me there's something going on the west edge of this moisture, like a dry line in through here. I can do a thermal analysis. And indeed, I've got a thermal axis right near this moisture discontinuity, tighter gradient to the west as well as north, and also some moisture gradient. So if I start to do the isobars, gives me an idea where the fronts are.